many researchers have these great ideas, their science is perfect, but they fail to look at the recruitment piece, and they may think they're going to be able to get a certain population, but when they put all of the inclusion-exclusion criteria as an overlay, that number of 25 or 30 may have been reduced to 2 or 3. You want to allow for a recruitment phase. So, you know, someone says, I got a year, or I'm hoping to get this in a year. Well, it takes them 6 months to get their design home. Maybe they have some IRB issues. And then they're like really feeling the deadline starting to close in, and they need to get their clinical trial started. And they really haven't allowed for what I call a recruitment phase. And you have to allow for that. You have to allow for a recruitment phase, especially if there's a screening process involved. Because I work in an area where we're working with people with disabilities. If you're a speech-language pathologist, you're working with people who have disabilities in communication. So the recruitment is going to be a little bit harder because of the very nature of the fact that they may have some disability in the communication and understanding, and you may be working with a family member. But recruiting for clinical trials in a population that has disabilities, some people have comorbidities, so people have problems. Maybe, you know, sometimes one of the problems is a lot of researchers will wait, they will say you need to wait till you're 6 months post onset of stroke, take that for instance. So maybe you've met this person during the admission process and you maybe have talked to them, but now you have to connect that dot to waiting during that time period. Also, sometimes recruiting when people have just gone through something very traumatic, like a brain injury, they've been a terrible brain injury or a stroke or a spinal cord injury. Well, you have to let them get through that process and that time, and you have to learn the skills of being able to contact at the right moment, not push too hard, and have the mechanisms for following up. A lot of it has to do with what number are you hoping to recruit for your trial. A lot of your funding is based on you, that someone will lend you money or give you money, not lend you, give you money, because you're saying, I'm going to recruit 50 participants. Now, the thing is, what size do you want your waiting list to be? If you're going to recruit people, some people may want 2 or 3 in queue. It also depends on the specificity. So I'll use an example. I worked with a lot of neuroscientists. Well, they want to do brain imaging. So one of the screening exclusions is metal. And so in your recruitment phase, if you're going to require that you do fMRI, and you know that metal's going to be an exclusion, you know that that's going to knock out a certain percentage of the folks you're going to work with. So to answer your question on a recruitment phase is, I think you need to, I would say, and this is just by the seat of my pants, you know, you need to allow a good 2 to 3 months for a recruitment phase if it's really a solid. But so that's a misconception is what's going to take, and people fail to have a plan and build that in, and they're just so excited about their science and their work, they just don't realize what it's going to take.